Welcome to Moving Forward. My name is Nikki Wimple. Tonight we'll be discussing rape, rape culture, and how we as a society can work to end it. With me is Naomi Wainright and Veronica Hamilton, both fellow UCSC students who have some expertise on the matter. Let's talk about first what rape culture is, so our viewers kind of get an understanding of what we're talking about. Rape culture is a term for a set of cultural attitudes that assume that rape is inevitable, consent is invisible, and victims are to blame for the crimes that are perpetrated against them because they have, quote unquote, asked for it. So let's talk about how the way women are portrayed in the media and fashion magazines can contribute to sexual violence against women. So we see images like the one of Madonna here. We see that she is framed to look like she is dead or has been victimized in some way. And in this way, the violence against women is sexualized. Do you have any thoughts on that or how these images are really contributing to rape? Like, how is that connected?
Yeah, I mean, I think the problem with that image and images like it is that it normalizes this violence. It's something that we're seeing all the time.
Exactly. So it desensitizes people to seeing women portrayed in this way and is also eroticizing that and making it almost desirable.
Yeah, I definitely think that it's kind of glorifying as well the idea that women can only be seen in this sexual docile position where they have been victimized. And we don't see that with men in fashion mm-hmm. magazines. We're not seeing, you know, like a woman standing over him or something like that to suggest that maybe he's been victimized. Mm-hmm. So it's very much one-sided. And I think it's dangerous to portray women like this because it's essentially saying that you can be violent against this woman. It is sexy. It is hot. Mm-hmm. It's something that should be glorified.
Yeah, and it's totally normal and goes without being questioned.
Yeah, it's like we don't even notice it anymore.
Yeah.
Yeah. So let's look at this in regards to something that's happened recently. I'm sure all of us know, and the viewers at home know, about the Miley Cyrus at the VMAs. Mm-hmm. Something that received a lot of controversy, you know, with her tongue sticking out, very sexually explicit performance, especially the VMAs that are supposed to be something that really anyone can tune into. And I think that a lot of this blame was put on Miley when in reality, why aren't we looking at Robin Thicke's role? Why do you think that we're heavily emphasizing Miley's role?
Yeah, I mean, I think the problem with that, the reason why we're looking so much at Miley and not at Robin Thicke, despite the fact that he's the one who's perpetuating these ideas of even if she says no, you should keep trying, mm-hmm. Is that Miley, she's breaking the rules in a way that she's reinforcing rape culture, but she's doing it like wearing the teddy bear costume, she's sticking her tongue out, and it's these kinds of ways that she's going against femininity, and so people are shocked by that, and then they're shocked by rape culture, where Robin Thicke is doing the thing that we're seeing all the time. And so that becomes normal. It's okay that he's doing that because he's a man, you know?
Mm-hmm. Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, I definitely think it's dangerous in that sense. I also think it's dangerous that, yes, it received a lot of backlash, but this is what young girls are looking to of, like, you know, this is what pop artists are doing nowadays. And if you are going to be a young, successful female pop artist or rap artist, then you have to sexualize yourself like this. You have to wear this getup and be dancing like this and do these sexually explicit things. And it's, we kind of lose the talent in that sense. Mm-hmm. We're just moving to something that women can do that. Also, Rihanna, think about, you know, the role models that Miley has. Rihanna's doing this. She's hugely successful. Her video, Pour It Up, is her practically naked doing the same things. And so, you know, I think what you're talking about before with the invisibility of it, it's like we're not noticing it, but what's happening is we're setting terrible, terrible examples for young girls.
Right.
Yeah, and I think a lot of the controversy over Miley Cyrus is just, it's it's looking at the wrong thing. There should be controversy over Miley Cyrus,
right.
But it shouldn't be because she's expressing her sexuality in this way necessarily. It should be that she's objectifying black women's bodies and commodifying their bodies and therefore contributing to rape culture disproportionately affecting black women.
Mm-hmm.
And she's not seeing it. I think that's where the outrage should be when we talk about Miley Cyrus, not that she's playing into the same culture that every woman in pop has to play into.
Right, and to explain that a little bit more, just for people that maybe don't understand how that's objectifying black women's bodies, we see that, you know, Miley receives a lot of attention, but she has her African-American female backup dancers who are wearing the teddy bears, who are literally the objects, and Miley goes up and actually spanks one of them. So I think when we're talking about that, that's what you mean, definitely, of we're making her an object to Miley Cyrus, who is a white woman's kind of prop, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And I definitely understand what you're saying by that. Let's look at something that is a local example in Santa Cruz that recently, or not so recently, about 2 years ago happened at the Museum of Modern Art and History. We had this glow fest, and it was freezing outside, and we had these almost go-go dancers who are wearing practically nothing.
Yeah. Right.
So did you hear about that, or could either of you kind of explain what's going on?
You know, I think we have a video on it too, is we have these women who are wearing little to nothing, and that's the reason people want to come and they want to dance, and these women are supposed to encourage people to have fun. But what we're seeing is that it's disproportionately women who are dressed, you know, this way. And you see the men, and they're completely clothed. And so it's like, what's the message that we're sending to the audience members, the young kids that are there? This was supposed to be a family event. So what message are we sending to young kids that men can be fully clothed while women's bodies are objectified in this way? That this is what women should be doing at cultural events,
right,
you know,
right.
Put on by the museum.
Put on the Museum of Art and History.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. It certainly is egregious. I definitely think also we had an image of Betty Burgers going up as well. And it's Betty's Burgers in general is known for a very sexual menu, if any of you have attended there, attended to eat. And it's it definitely objectifies women in that sense. The logo is this woman who's a pinup doll, essentially, right?
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, what does this have to do with food, right? Like, what
yeah.
does this have to do with food? But there it is. So we talk about these women too at the Glow Fest, and it's like, it's invisible. It's something we walk by every day. We're not noticing it. We're not, you know, mm-hmm. giving attention to it. But here it is. It's women everywhere in sexual positions.
Yeah.
And it has nothing to do with what we're actually doing. Again, you mentioning that it's at a museum. I mean, come on, you know, there are kids.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Yeah, I think with the Betty's Burgers example, the idea is that it's supposed to be this like vintage feel, it's ironic sexism, but if you're still doing it and you're still putting the sexualized woman as your, you know, as your mascot for your business, it's still sexist. It,
right.
Even if you
yeah.
think that it's you're being vintage, you're being coy or whatever, it's still sexist.
Mm-hmm.
And I think a good point to mention is that the MA took criticism about the Dancernauts at their Glow Fest and have decided not to include them next year, which is,
that's good.
You know, it's nice to hear when businesses take feedback like that, and
yeah.
they listen to the people that they're supposed to be serving.
Especially in Santa Cruz, I mean, we're such a progressive city. I think, you know, it's definitely horrifying when you see it in a city like this that claims to be very educated on these matters. So I think it's definitely good that we've made changes to make it more family friendly and also less sexist, obviously. So let's look at some popular artists that have sent the message, so to speak, that blur the lines between consensual sex and rape, since we already kind of discussed it in terms of Miley. But let's go back to that, because I know we had many people have seen the video Blurred Lines by Robin Thicke. So let's look at a parody of this that kind of mocks how that is sending the message that rape is okay.
Boy, you'd better quit all your sexist ways. So here our manifesto of the modern age. It's time to undermine the masculine confines, 'cause we don't wanna grind. You don't assume that we all just wanna screw. Gotta respect me for me to be a boo. We don't want no scrubs, no, we don't approve. Need a universal role reversal in real life, not a dress rehearsal. Gotta resist all the gender roles. Time to put misogyny on parole, put exploitation on probation. Time for you to witness our liberation. There's more to life than penetration and sexual discrimination. So tonight we ignite our civil rights, resist chauvinism, win the fight. 'Cause you're living large, just like a montage of you and your friends acting out. Entourage. But we ain't whores to do your household chores, to make you a sandwich when we're on all fours. From history to herstory, know you got some opinions that we don't agree. Need to call my sister Joan of ARC, a bigger feminist cake, Antoinette Marie. Yeah, guys, we got spies. Now all you wanna do is fertilize. But avert your eyes from my thighs. Never tell a bitch you gotta drop a size. You want a box cap? Show me a six pack. You want a landing strip? You better get ripped. I apologize if you think my lines are crass. Tell me how it feels to get verbally harassed.
So this man's world. If you wanna get nasty, just don't harass me. You can't just grab me. That's a sex crime. Yeah, we don't want it. It's chauvinistic. You're such a bigot.
So I think that's a great video that kind of moves us into also thinking about how it's silly that in the video of Blurred Lines with Robin Thicke, these women are doing essentially the same things that we just saw in the parody. Yet again, it's invisible. We see this theme that's super prevalent. However, when we see men in these positions, in these videos, on all fours, doing what these women are doing, it's weird, mm-hmm. right? And so that kind of leads me to the next topic that I want to discuss in regards to rape culture is how is the definition of what it means to be masculine contributing to sexual violence against women? For me personally, I think that it's the fact that men are keep hearing these things like be manly, take what's yours, you are entitled to it, that can be really dangerous. And I think that men, as much as women, you know, maybe, you know, not as much as the victims of rape and stuff, but as much as women are still being threatened by this idea of masculinity because they have to live up to this and they have to get a woman, and instead they can't have these honest relationships where, you know, a man and a woman are mutually respected. So I think it's very harmful in that way. Do you have any thoughts on that, either of you?
Yeah, I mean, I think I agree with you in that men are certainly deprived of maybe being open about being vulnerable in certain ways or emotional. And I do think I agree that like the way young boys are conditioned from their early age to be strong and assertive does sort of coincide with the things that maybe contribute to the situation in which a person might rape someone.
Yeah, definitely. We have a video that actually sums that up. It's called The Mask Men Live In. Let's take a look at that.
Stop crying.
Don't cry.
You need to pick yourself up.
Don't be weak.
Always keep your mouth shut.
Nobody likes a tattletale.
Bros, don't let your woman run your life, alright?
Be a man.
Be a man.
Do something.
So man up.
Man up.
Man up.
Man up.
Act like a man.
Be a man.
We've constructed an idea of masculinity that doesn't give young boys a way to feel secure, so we make them go prove it all the time.
Each of them is posturing based on how the other boys are posturing, and what they end up missing is what they each really want, which is just that closeness.
I want you to write, what is it you don't let people see? Almost 90% of you have pain and anger on the back of that paper. That's not a coincidence.
They really buy into a culture that doesn't value what we've feminized. They begin to devalue their relational parts to themselves, their relational desires.
We need to redefine strength in men, not as the power over other people, but as forces for justice. We're giving them a great gift when we're teaching men how to be men in ways that integrate caring and compassion into strength.
So I think that video definitely encompasses what you were saying before about how socialization is a key factor in men feeling maybe obligated that that is the only way that they can have sex, and exert themselves sexually. At the same time, though, we do have to acknowledge that, you know, this is individuals making a choice to exert violence over another human being. I definitely like the clip we're about to watch. It talks about holding men responsible for rape, which we so infrequently do. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. We're putting all this blame, and I know you're going to speak to this a little bit later, but we put all this blame on, like, oh, you know, or women, it's your job to not get raped. But really, we need to be telling them also, well, you need to not rape. So let's check out this clip by Zerlina Maxwell on Fox News.
Women, they're telling them to use a ballpoint pen. A ballpoint pen?
That's ridiculous as well. But I don't think that we should be telling women anything. I think we should be telling men not to rape women and start the conversation there.
Well, criminals are not going to listen to that.
No, but
so I agree with you.
We're not. I mean, yes,
but
men are committing a crime, but many of the men that commit
are not
rape
listen
are people
to Sean
that
Hannity.
Know.
But no man should do that to anybody.
You're talking about it as if there's some faceless, nameless criminal. When it a lot of times it's someone that you know and trust.
Well, I'm saying that women need to know that these situations arise, and we've got to, evil exists in the world.
Yes, but
evil
exists. We can prevent rape by telling men not to commit it.
They're
no,
not
that's
going
not right.
To,
that
criminals will not listen.
No, we're not talking about criminals.
I want women,
we're talking about a cultural.
I want women to be able to protect themselves, don't you?
I want women to be able to protect themselves, yes. But I want women to not be in this situation.
And by, I agree
but they're
going to be in that
no,
situation.
No, that's not true. If you train men not to grow up to become rapists, you prevent
you
rape.
Think you can
that
stop,
is the
you
core
think,
of the
You think
problem.
You can tell a rapist to stop doing what he's doing?
Yes.
You really? And he's going to listen to an ad campaign
There are
to stop?
Organizations that do this. Men can stop rape. Men stopping violence. They train young men to not rape.
And you think
over
you can stop
90%
every rapist?
Of violent crime in the U.S. occurs without a firearm. And when you look at these studies that say women are more likely to be raped than to be able to defend themselves.
If firearms
the
were the answer,
right.
Then the military would be the safest place for women, and it's not.
But knowing that there are evil people, I want women protected, and they've got to protect themselves. But thank you both.
Tell
I'm sorry that
rape.
Happened. It shouldn't happen.
So I think that's an excellent idea of, you know, a woman standing up and saying we can prevent this thing to begin with. Of course, you know, maybe criminals who have already committed this crime aren't going to listen, but what about young boys? We're socializing them, aren't we? So let's teach them not to be rapists. It seems like if we take more preventative action, it might work out better for everyone in the long run.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
And it's so interesting the way he said I believe exactly that, like, evil is in the world, and so that's sort of like how can we even get around this issue? Like, it's innate, it should exist, it's just part of the world, whereas we have to, like, imagine other ways of, you know, creating people, which is like what you're saying with socializing boys at a young age.
Yeah, definitely. I think that's actually a very good segue into the next clip we're gonna watch. It's called Flirting with Danger. It looks at, you know, what are the implications for young women who are living in this rape culture. And also, it starts to point us into the last topic we're going to discuss, which is really what can we do to change the culture we live in? Because as Zerlina Maxwell points out, you know, we can do it. It's something that with prevention and hard work, we can do it. So let's watch this clip and then we'll discuss that.
I don't know what to think. I don't know who to be, really, because I'm damned if I do, damned if I don't sort of thing, and I can't sort out what I want because it's hard to separate from what's expected of me.
But the thing is that all the different things that people expect from me, those are all parts of me, I just don't know which one to choose.
It's a constant balancing act. You can't look too willing or experienced, like you can't be more experienced than the guy is, and you can't come off looking like a slut because then you'll look really bad. No, I don't think that I would call it abuse or victimization or anything, because even though it might look that way with his hand over my mouth and his hurting me and all, I don't think that I could ever call myself a victim.
The fact that he forced me, I mean, it happened within a whole lot of other things. So I don't think it's really fair to women who have actually been attacked to call me a victim of rape.
One of the most striking things I hear from young women I talk to is that they never shared their stories before because they didn't think anyone would understand.
It feels really good to be able to tell someone that.
I want to say to young women who hear echoes of your own experiences in these stories, you are not alone. And it's important that we come together to share our experiences, not just to get them off our chests, but to use them collectively to demand change.
So I think that video, though, it's clearly shocking, especially the part of when his hand was over my mouth. It really shows the danger, and again, of the blurring of the lines, where it's like women don't understand or don't know to understand that maybe what they're experiencing isn't a normal thing, you know? Because if you're receiving all these mixed messages within society, how do you know definitively what rape is, mm-hmm. if the lines are always blurred, right? Mm-hmm. So let's move away from that. Let's put that aside for a second, and let's talk about how we can collectively move for change. I think I definitely want to leave our viewers with some ways that we can start doing things today that move to dismantle rape culture. Would either of you like to propose ways that we could do that to our viewer at home?
Well, I think that there is a lot of different ways that we can address rape culture and try to end it, and it spans from teaching women not to feel like their rape was illegitimate, teaching women that if this happened to you, if you didn't want to have sex and it happened anyway, you shouldn't feel like it was your fault.
Right.
There are so many different reasons that rape goes unnoticed because we're teaching women that if you said no, but eventually said yes, then sucks for you, you know?
Yeah.
If we're teaching women that if it didn't happen in a dark alley, then it wasn't rape, then these women are getting denied the services that they need. Mm-hmm. If they're experiencing things like this, then they should have services just like the woman who got attacked in the alley. They're different, but they're both rape.
Mm-hmm.
I think a lot of it has to do with raising awareness for women to feel like their experience is legitimate, but also to tell men that this is not the way we want to go about things. If you want sex, you know, you don't just force it.
Right, negotiating sex, yeah.
Right, mm-hmm. right.
Yeah, it has definitely been a term that's been thrown around, again, negotiating sex. It's something that's been seen as so, you know, unsexy. You see in all these movies, for example, even protection, for example, like the use of contraceptives is something that's so taboo that they don't even show it mm-hmm. in movies. Like,
yeah.
You know, so what are we teaching kids? Like, this is what they should be doing?
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's dangerous. I think a way that we can get around doing that is having comprehensive sex ed programs, ones that show, you know, what are the benefits of abstinence if that's what you so choose? What is the benefit of a healthy sexual relationship? When will you be ready? Where can you find contraceptives? How can you talk with your parents and adults about this or your doctor? It's making it less invisible. I think if we make sex less invisible or taboo of a topic, we can start talking about ways in which to end rape, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Naomi, did you have anything to add about how we can increase the visibility of women, maybe, as a means to change rape culture?
Yeah, I think it's important that we make more efforts to, like, work with our young people to specifically make it impossible to see young women and girls as objects, as weak. And co-ed sports is a really good example of that, encouraging more co-ed sports. So if you think about sports as like this context in which boys and men are encouraged to be aggressive mm-hmm. and masculine, and those are things that are key to being good at sports, and it's also something that's like really precious to our culture. So if we had men and women competing together or working together in that context specifically, and showing that women can be physically strong too, you know, I think that would make it a lot more difficult to take advantage of a woman if she's not some sort of like weak object that you can exact your force upon.
Yeah, absolutely. I agree. Also, you know, as consumers, we have the power to not buy into things that, you know, encourage rape culture. Mm-hmm. You know, whenever Blurred Lines comes on, it comes on to our Santa Cruz station all the time. Just flip the channel, yeah. You know? Mm-hmm. And kind of the last thing that I want to say about that is if you're, you know, young women, if you're at a party and you see your friend or another woman who's in a situation that's dangerous, if she's too intoxicated, if a guy, you know, is feeding her alcohol, let's work mm-hmm. to, you know, find a way for her to get home or take names yeah. or ask the young man, hey, like, I don't know you. What's your name? What's mm-hmm. your deal? Because, yeah, it might be scary to speak up, but at the end of the day, you might be saving, you know, a fellow woman from a harmful situation. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Do either of you quickly have any last thoughts that you'd like to leave our viewers with or any last ways to get involved?
I think, you know, looking at feminist blogs, paying attention to legislation.
Yeah.
Maybe viewers can look up CalVCP, look up different ways in which our laws affect rape culture, because it's top down as well as bottom up.
Right.
Yeah. And just to agree with what you're saying, I think we have to start looking beyond sort of like this myopic scope of life. There can be alternate realities now.
Yeah.
And like taking responsibility for others is a huge part of that. And yeah, taking, you know, it doesn't have to be the way it is.
Perfect. Yeah. All right, well, I think that will wrap up tonight's discussion on that. Thank you so much, both of you, for joining me. Viewers at home, get involved. It's something that it's important, and rape culture, it is invisible, but you can do a lot as an individual, and you can also do a lot as a collective group. So thanks again for joining us, and tune in next time.